In the book of Genesis, Abraham is told to come out of Babylon. In the book of Revelation, the believers are told to come out of Babylon.
Amen.
But yet, no one is being taught what Babylon really is. What is Babylon? What are they talking about? Right now, we're coming up on one of my favorite times of the year. Easter. Easter. It's one of my favorite times of year. Last year, I went to, from Israel, I flew down to South Africa because I prayed about it and I knew that last year that I was to go and celebrate all the feasts in exile. Instead of doing it at my home in Israel, instead of inviting people to come over there to celebrate the feast of Yahweh, then I'm going to go into exile. So I went down to Africa. And, I'm going down there to see how much excitement I can torch up. I'm just a one-man band for the most part. Someone went down there to help me. But I had a little bit of soreness in my throat. And I walked into a pharmacy to get a lozenge for my throat. And when I was checking out, I saw on the end cap, this is just before Easter, all these bunny rabbits and these Easter eggs and all that business. I saw all that, and so I walked up to the cashier. There were about eight people behind me, and I said in a very loud voice, and see, they speak English down there, but they speak kind of a British accent English. So, they know immediately I don't belong there as soon as I open my mouth that I'm a foreigner. So I walked up there and to pay for this, and I said, I didn't know that you people were into Babylonian pagan sun god worship down here. And, I said it loud enough to where everyone in line and for about four aisles back could hear this. And the cashier looked at me and said, well, what are you talking about? And then I then did about a 10-minute presentation right there with everybody in line, teaching them what Babylon is and about the sun god worship cult that was developed in Babylon. And they are taking part in this today. And so this is why this is one of my favorite times of year, because I went down there to stir up trouble, but I also went down there to teach them about Passover, because Passover is one of the feasts of the Lord that the Brit Hasha, the New Testament, says are prophetic shadow pictures of good things to come. They are literally the mechanism whereby the Almighty has told us the end of time from the very beginning. He has embedded the feast of the Lord with these prophetic shadow pictures that in the Western world, we grow up knowing nothing about these things. We are given Christmas and Easter, which are the high days of Babylonian sun worship, and we know nothing about Passover and the Bikurim and Shavuot and Sukkot and Hanukkah. Yeshua celebrated Hanukkah in the Gospel of John. It records this. Hanukkah and Christmas are the same feast. It's just one is the pagan side, the other one is deliverance from pagan sun god worship. That's what, so, want to wear a t-shirt, WWJD? Well, why don't we read what he did and do what he did? I love this time of year. And so when I was down there, I got to be on National Public Radio two times while I was down there. They won't let me on NPR in America, but they let me on there. We had a great time. And we had to cut off the registration for Passover a week before Passover because we already had 250 people signed up, and that's all we could hold. Mm-hmm. And so we did a big Passover blowout down there, the first time that in South Africa something like that was done. And so we had a great time. But what is this? Abraham was told to come out of Babylon in Genesis. We go all the way to the end of the Hebrew Scriptures in the book of Revelation. The believers are told to come out of Babylon. What is this Babylon, and what is it that we are called to come out of? And I want to point out something in the book of Revelation, that it says that Babylon is going to be destroyed. Babylon will be judged. Babylon is a system. It's not just an ancient city in Mesopotamia. It is a system. And if we're not told about the system, then we can become entrapped in Babylon and never pull ourselves out, never understand it, and never know how to extricate ourselves. And this is extremely important in the book of Revelation, because it says that at the time that Babylon is judged by the Almighty, and that's why the believers are told to come out of Babylon, it says that the merchants of Babylon, the merchants, these are the people that are making the money. These are the ones that are pulling the strings and making the entire system work. The merchants of Babylon are the great men of the earth. A repeating theme throughout the book of Revelation. These are those who run nations. These are the ones that loan money to nations in order to get these nations in hock to where in the days of Roosevelt, the United States literally went into default with the World Bank, and it was in receivership at that point. That's why all of our birth certificates are printed on banknotes, because every person is monetized by the World Bank, because we are sold into bondage, into our lifetime of paying taxes, so that the United States of America, which went into default, can pay pay its debt to the World Bank. All we're doing right now, and what we've been doing for now over a generation, is just paying the interest on the debt. But the great men of the earth, the merchants of Babylon, they deceive the nations. They deceive the nations, the entire world. They deceive through pharmakia. Amen. Pharmakia. Now, this word is not to be taken lightly, because we can take that word pharmakia in Greek, and we can go back all the way back into the prophets and see that at the time that the Torah and the prophets were translated from Hebrew into Greek, first of all, at the request of Philadelphus, who wanted a history of the Hebrew people when he conquered and occupied Israel. But when there were certain Hebrew words that they then translated into pharmakia, and every one of them is a warning from the Almighty of what would happen where women would end up widows and children would end up orphans because of this pharmakia. The pharmakia is how the great men of this earth have drawn people into this. Where is that piece of pharmakia that you had right here? And I have to do a disclaimer here. Crest has been proven to be an effective dentifrice when, where am I? I don't have my glasses. Crest has been proven. Here we go. Oh no, don't tell me it's not there anymore. When conscientiously applied with a regular program of oral hygiene and regular professional dental care. Okay, there's my advertisement for Crest. Ladies and gentlemen, this is pharmakia. The ingredients in this were created in a laboratory. The human body, which is organic, cannot handle anything on the cellular level that is made in a laboratory. We are made from the dust of the earth. The plants are made from the dust of the earth. The animals are made from the dust of the earth. They are all organic. Those things can nourish the body. They can nourish the cell. But if what has been replaced on our tables and everything we're ingesting is pharmakia, that which is man-made, that is what is destroying us. This is what has turned America into the sickest nation on the planet. Amen. There is not another nation on planet Earth that has the sickness rampant, and that the believers are dropping dead like flies every day. And now that we're of this age, see, it used to be in my grandparents' day that, you know, when people hit 70 and 80s, that's when they started dropping like flies. No, they're dropping like flies in their 50s now. The children are dropping like flies. At 3 and 4 years old, they're developing cancers that were not even seen in a previous generation. And the great men of the earth, the merchants of Babylon are trying to convince us that, hey, everything is okay, there's nothing wrong with this. No, if it's man-made, it doesn't belong in the human body. It is destroying us, but they can produce it at very cheap
prices,
very little cost to them, by manufacturing this stuff in laboratories, and it is killing us. The great men of the earth, through pharmakia, are deceiving the nations, and this is what is happening. Let's go back to Babylon for just a minute. Because in order to understand the end time Babylon, we have to understand the early Babylon. And we know a good bit of this from the scripture, and then also just history. And living in Israel, I'm going to tell you things that are just commonly known. It's just common knowledge in the land of Israel. Because again, we went into Babylon. And even when we came out, didn't we just get through celebrating Purim? I see the mask up here. We just got through celebrating Purim. Well, Purim wouldn't have happened if all the Jews had come out of Babylon and come back into the land of Israel. But Hadassah, Esther, Mordecai, you know, they were among the hundreds of thousands of Jews that stayed behind. The book of Esther all takes place after we've come back and rebuilt the temple in Jerusalem. And so most of the Jews stayed in Babylon. And we, until just recently, there were still a lot of Jews in Babylon. And so it was a lot of people escaped with barely their lives. And we have some of the Torah scrolls that were in Babylon. I've got one in my home, an ancient Torah scroll, over 300 years old, that was in Babylon. I've got another one at my office. Many of these ancient Torah scrolls, the five books of Moses, were rescued out of Babylon. Hundreds of years old these are. And it helps us to understand the history, because in the book of Revelation it tells us that Nimrod was the one who built Babylon. And it was a political, an economic, a world government system. Social, economic, political, monetary, the whole thing. Nimrod was worshipped as God. The entire population was enslaved under Nimrod. And according to tradition, it was Shem, the righteous son of Noah, that slew Nimrod. They killed him and hacked his body up into little bitty pieces and spread it all over the land of Shinar, which should have ended the worship of Nimrod. But it turns out that's not what happened. Semiramis, Nimrod's wife, determining that she was not going to let this world empire slip through her fingers so readily, said that Nimrod really didn't die. He has ascended up into the heavens and has become the sun. And then priests were put in place to then put in place all the accoutrements of the sun worship. It was Babylon. They are the brilliant mathematicians that the modern day Christian calendar is basically the same calendar that was invented in Babylon. It is a sun calendar. The biblical calendar is completely different than that. And the Jewish calendar is different from the biblical calendar. The modern Jewish calendar is different from the biblical calendar. That was changed in the year 359 of the Common Era, again in Tiberias, right down below my house. The last act of the Sanhedrin before going into exile was to change the Creator's calendar into a calculated reckoning of time whereby all Israelites could celebrate the feast no matter where they were scattered abroad upon the planet. But the Creator's calendar is a different calendar and was in place until that moment in 359. That is how Israel kept the feast according to the Creator's original calendar. Something that in the West we've grown up in ignorance of, but for me, you know, I think in the Creator's calendar. You think in the Gregorian calendar, I think in the Creator's calendar. And sometime I'll tell you a little bit about it. Get a video called The Creator's Calendar. 4.5 hours, get the calendar. Yeah, I'll teach you all about that and that. We don't have that time today,
no,
do we?
We don't.
We don't have 4.5 hours. Okay, good. Thankfully. Okay, so we have produced over 20 volumes of DVDs to help people get connected with Israel, the land, the language, and to understand the Bible. my main job has been for the last decade and a half is to teach Christian pastors how to understand the New Testament by teaching them the Torah and the prophets. And once that's understood, it's like, you know, it blows their mind. And and it's just a treat to be able to do that around the world and help people understand the Bible in its context. So now getting back to the worship of Nimrod and setting up the worship of Nimrod and the priest of Nimrod, the Semiramis, all put in place, it was the Babylonians that divided the year into four quadrants: the winter solstice, the summer solstice, the shortest day of the year, the longest day of the year, the vernal and autumnal equinoxes, the days in the year of equal daylight and equal darkness. Winter solstice, summer solstice, vernal autumnal equinox. Winter solstice, summer solstice, vernal autumnal equinox. Amen. So the priest of Easter divided the year into the four quadrants as they are developing the worship of Nimrod as the sun god. Now, quite a while after his death, his wife becomes pregnant. But not in a way that you might expect. No. She says that the rays of her dead husband Nimrod, who is now the sun, have impregnated her. And now she then is pregnant by the rays of the sun, and then she delivers her firstborn child, and his name is Tammuz. Ah, okay. Now we come back to Ezekiel chapter 8. That's where you've all heard about Tammuz. You know, there's an abomination going on in the temple. There were women in the temple weeping for Tammuz. It's called an abomination. Well, what is this weeping for Tammuz? Well, first of all, let me tell you that Tammuz was born at the time of the winter solstice. The reincarnated sun god is now born at the time of the winter solstice, which on the ancient Babylonian calendar, before the precession of equinoxes, was December 25th. Now the winter solstice is around December 21st, but this is the birthday of little baby Tammuz, the reincarnated Nimrod, December 25th. And so every year they would have a child mass or a child sacrifice on December 25th in the worship of Nimrod. And this is where this whole child mass and the winter solstice and all this comes from. Being in Israel, we were carried away, into Babylon. We know that Tammuz, the Babylonian sun god, is born on December 25th. We are also taken into captivity into Egypt. Ra, the Egyptian sun god, his birthday is December 25th. The Greeks came in. Antiochus Epiphanes put a statue of Jupiter on the Temple Mount, slaughtered a pig, roasted it on the holy altar, and it was on Jupiter's birthday, December 25th. Then later, the Romans came in and occupied Israel. They came in and crucified people on the cross of Mithra. The birthday of Mithra, the Roman sun god, is December 25th. The cross was on the battle standards of the Roman army 100 years before the birth of Yeshua, because it was a symbol of Mithra, the Persian sun god, who then the Romans adopted. Oh, who did I miss? Jupiter. Jupiter and Zeus. Zeus, December 25th. So, some people are kind of shocked to hear that here in the West. But, it was once illegal in America for a church to have its doors open on December 25th. The pastor would be locked up because they knew, the founding fathers knew it was Babylonian sun worship, and they said, we will have none of it in this country. But now we've grown up knowing nothing about history. We have been, our history has been changed, and now we've got a problem. We don't even understand Babylon when it comes at us from all sides. Let's go ahead into the future a little bit, because turns out that this god, Tammuz, doesn't fare too well. He is a great hunter, like his father, but in his 40th year, he is gored to death in a freak hunting accident by a wild boar. And so they set aside 40 days of weeping for Tammuz, in which they would deny themselves a pleasure in this life for the pleasure of Tammuz in his afterlife. Now, I have to remind you, I'm not telling you my personal beliefs. I'm telling you about Babylonian sun worship here, okay? right? So then it turns out he dies in his 40th year. They had the 40 days set aside for weeping for Tammuz. And then later his mother dies. Now when his mother dies, she is so holy, she immediately ascends into heaven, and the gods christen her as the Queen of Heaven and send her back to earth on the first Sunday after the vernal equinox in the spring. They send her back to earth in this giant egg, which hurtles down from space, plummets in the Euphrates River. The egg breaks open, and out emerges Semiramis, reincarnated as Easter, the bare-breasted sex goddess who turns a bird into an egg-laying rabbit to proclaim her divinity. Then they stack the 40 days of weeping for Tammuz up to be the 40 days preceding Easter Sunday, when Semiramis was reincarnated. And now we have what they call Lent, in which the sun god worshippers deny themselves a pleasure in this life for the pleasure of Tammuz in his afterlife. And then on Easter Sunday, they eat the wild boar that killed Tammuz, eating ham on Easter Sunday. Ladies and gentlemen, that is Babylonian sun worship. How many of you have unknowingly, unwittingly, like myself, participated in Babylonian sun worship in your congregations, any churches you went to? I see that hand. Okay, not with every head bowed and every eye closed, you don't look around. It's man-made. It is the worship of man. The worship of man as God. That is what it was originally, and the Babylonian system is still in place today. And now we are worshiping doctors as God who cannot be challenged, who refuse to answer questions, the simplest questions, because they can deal with trauma. Oh, they did a marvelous job dealing with my trauma. They put me in the MRI tubes, and they x-rayed me, and they dissected me, and they ran every test they could, and all they could do was to give me pharmakia, man-made chemicals to reduce inflammation and to kill pain, because they have no idea what's wrong with me. Why? Because we have been introduced to a world in which there is no God. That we are the result of millions of years of aberrant chance mutations in a purely mechanical universe. We are just stardust getting ready to dissolve. And we got here by random chance mutations. Oh, yeah, right. I mean, you got to be a complete moron to believe that. I'm sorry if I'm offending any morons. But if there is no purpose to this physical conscious experience we call life, I mean, you know, you can't even be an American if you do not believe in a creator. You know, this is what we said. We started out this way. We, Americans, we hold these truths to be self-evident. All men are created equal, in that they are endowed by their creator with absolute inalienable rights. I know they use the word certain, but it's absolute. It's not particular, it's absolute inalienable rights. Rights that no king, no pope, no president, no one has the right to strip from the individual. Amen. And now we have allowed people who do not even believe in a creator to take office in our country and make legislation. I mean, how stupid are we? I mean, if there is no creator, there are no creator-given rights. You only have government-given rights. And what the government taketh, the government surely will taketh away. And are doing so. There are only 613 commandments in the entire Torah. Most of them don't even apply. You know, some are just for women, some are just for children, some are just for men, others are only if you are a Levite among men, and others only if you are the family of Aaron, and on the day of Yom Kippur, you are the Kohen Gadol, the high priest, and those commandments concerning that only apply to that one man, and the temple is gone. I mean, the Creator has given us just, you know, a handful. But in America, there are 2.1 million laws now that apply to everyone. You tell me who's under the law. Yeah. Yeshua delivered us from man-made rules and regulations. And this is what is not understood. When the commandments were given to us from Mount Sinai, the basic foundational commandment is, thou shalt not add one single commandment to the commandments that I give you. You shall not diminish one single commandment. No one's allowed to add, no one's allowed to subtract. If anyone ever adds one single commandment, he is a false prophet. If anyone ever takes away one single commandment, they are a false prophet. And the Almighty said, I am going to send you a test. I am going to empower false prophets who will be able to do signs, miracles, and wonders to try you, to see if you'll keep my commandments like you promised, or if you'll just follow men.
Amen.
And what has happened is that people have taken Yeshua, turned him into a Greek idol, extracted a few words that they like that he says, but ignore all the hard stuff that he says, and made up their own man-made religion around him. And then they took it and mixed it with Babylonian sun worship, and now we have, voila. You know, we have American paganized Christianity that they read the Bible and they have no idea what they're reading. They're not connected with the land, the culture, the language, the Torah that Yeshua said he didn't come to do away with. And now we find ourselves at the end of history in America. And we see people dropping dead like flies. I'm crippled. I can't get around anymore. And then I come down to Boca Raton for the Day of Trumpets. Yeah, this last fall, and I got down here. I was doing well. I was feeling great, working hard. After the whole event was over, I went back to Michigan. As soon as I got back there, bam, I was in a wheelchair again. I met Dr. Gary Tunsky at that particular feast, and he stood up to speak about the swine flu and some of the things that were going on with this Babylonian pharmakia. And so... when this hit me, he invited me to come down. So I got in my vehicle, I got my crutches, and I was in so much pain, I slept in my vehicle on the way down. I could not even imagine trying to get into a hotel. And so I slept in the vehicle on the way down, using my crutches to get the gas. I got down here, and I was actually doing a little bit better when I got back down here, a little bit better. On crutches, but within a week of this detoxification and getting the pharmakia out of my system, then I was doing 3.5 miles on the wet sand of the beach at the end of the week, doing 5 miles the next week. And because I started to get cleaned up of this, then we found out what was going on. Because as I was going to specialist after specialist through the Veterans Administration, they kept asking me if I was in the Gulf War. And I said, no. And, I almost went back into the Marines to do that particular stint in the first episode of the Gulf War. But no, I said, no, I didn't. And I kept on being asked that question. And then they're telling me, well, we're treating many Gulf War veterans with the same symptoms that you have. And I didn't put anything together on that, but it kept on coming up. And then as I was out on the road during this period of time, people knowing that I was in pain and I was having trouble, and sometimes I'd go up to the stage in crutches, I would sit down on a stool, and I would teach from there for the next 4 hours instead of standing up, because I couldn't stand on my legs. And so they come up and tell me what was going on with them. And here are Gulf War veterans with some of the same systems, but they weren't in the Gulf War either. What did we all have in common?